My name is Jackson Bogdan, and this is how I walk through the door. When I was younger, we were coming to church as a family. I can remember checking into the kids' room and getting my name tag. Then, when I was 9 years old, my stepdad, who I was really close with, passed away. It was hard for me as a boy. I didn't know it at the time, but looking back now, I can see something else died when my stepdad passed. It was that part of my childhood, and it was my ability to understand God, to know that relationship with God. The next 7 or 8 years of my life, there was what felt like a struggle. I was disinterested, my grades in school were bad, my relationships were all tense. It was hard to get along with my mom, my teachers, my coaches. I was unenthusiastic about everything. Then, last year, a friend invited me to go back to church. I hadn't been to church since my stepdad's memorial service. And instantly, as soon as I walked through the door, something was different. I felt like this is where I belong. I kept coming back to church and really learning about Jesus now that I'm old enough to understand for myself. I decided to put my life in the hands of God. Now, I feel alive again. That's the best way I can describe it. It's easier for me to respect people and have relationships that feel good. I feel like I have a purpose and direction. This year, I was baptized during a church service to celebrate that new life. To celebrate that I've been made new, that my death was put to death. I'm Jackson, and my death has been put to death.
Yeah. Oh man, I had to watch that 25 times last night, so I didn't cry when I walked up here. I love that story. Happy Easter, everybody. Today we announce that the third day is the best day, and that he is risen. And we announce resurrection. And Jackson's story can be true, my story can be true, your story of death, being put to death, can be true because of Jesus. If you're here today, I imagine it's because at some level, Easter matters to you. If you're watching online, it's because at some level, you might not even be sure why or have the language for it, but Easter, it's significant to you. It matters to you. Maybe somebody just promised you a nice brunch today. I don't know. But chances are pretty good. You're here because Easter matters to you. It's a significant moment. And if I had the opportunity to go to coffee with each and every one of you today, which I can't because that is a lot of coffee. But if I could, and if I were to sit down with some of us today, some of you, you might say something along the lines, if I said, hey, why did you come to church? Why does Easter matter to you? There's a group of us, if you were honest, and it might take you a few moments to admit this, but 10 minutes in, 20 minutes into the coffee, you might lean across the table and say, you know what, Jared, if I'm honest with you, I'm a cynic, I'm a skeptic. I love the idea of Easter, but when it comes to the idea of a dead man walking out of a tomb, I mean, in a post-scientific world, come on. I just can't bite on that idea. And I would lean across the table and thank you for your honesty. And if I pushed you a little bit more and said, okay, then why do you celebrate Easter? There's a lot of us, you might say, well, I believe it wasn't literally true. And this is a lot of people in the world. They would say it's not literally true, but it points to like a higher truth. It didn't actually happen, but in a way, Easter's always kind of happening. Every winter has a spring. Every door that closes, another door opens. Everything that dies, it gives way for something to live. And maybe you kind of celebrate it in a Elton John, Circle of Life, Lion King sort of a way. To which I would lean across the table and I would thank you for your honesty. There's a lot of us today, if I were to ask you what's significant to you about Easter, why do you celebrate? You would maybe say something along the lines of, you know, Jesus died for me, and this is a time of year to recalibrate my faith. It's a time to remember the sacrifice that Jesus made. Maybe it's a time to kind of reflect on the gory details of the crucifixion and to remember the price that was paid. There's something about sacrifice that's just woven into the fabric of this time of year. That might be what you talk about. You might even tell me what you gave up for Lent. Maybe you have friends that gave something up for Lent. You ever notice people give up all kinds of strange things for Lent? I was talking with a guy the other day, and he said, I can't wait for Lent to be over. I said, why? He goes, I gave up carbohydrates. Which is like, I don't know if that's Lent. That's paleo. That's very, very different. Anybody else go on a Easter diet, you know, like the whole 40, man? But it's something in the fabric of this time of year. We think of sacrifice. We think of the sacrifice that Jesus made. And if that's you, that's a beautiful thing to do. If I were to get coffee, and this is what I want to explore together today. If I had coffee with the disciples, if you went to coffee with John, who wrote this story down, and maybe you don't even believe their eyewitness account, but if you, I mean, you have to be interested enough to sit down with them and say, why did you write this story down? If you were to sit down with the apostles, if you were to sit down with the people who originally saw this story, and you said, what does Easter mean to you? I think you would get a different answer than the one that we would often give. And I don't give a lot of three-point sermons around here today, but it's Easter, and I'm cleaning my act up a little bit. There's three things I think the disciples would say. I think John would say, as you read the sweep of the New Testament, if you were to sit down with Paul, who wrote a majority of the New Testament, and you said, what is Easter about? I think they would say three things. The first thing they would say, Easter is a historical event. Somebody saw something. I think they would also say, and we're going to explain these one by one, Easter is an irritating reality. And I think that's true for you, and I think it's true for me if we really think about it. If you don't just spiritualize it and set it on the shelf, Easter is an irritating reality. It has to be. We'll explain that in just a moment. I think third, they would say Easter put death to death. I think they would say it was so personal to them. It wasn't just bunnies and chocolate, although all those things are great. It was so personal to them because they saw it. It became an irritating reality in their life. And it wasn't just about the death of Jesus. It was about their death and about the death of anyone who passes away in this world. If you have a Bible, let's read the story together. John chapter 20. There's four accounts of the Easter story. John is my favorite. I'll tell you why in just a moment. John chapter 20, this is the word of the Lord. If you have a Bible, you can follow along, or you can follow along on the screens. That's a great place to follow along as well. John chapter 20, starting in verse 1. Early on, the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So it's Mary Magdalene, it's a woman, that's significant, we'll come back to that in a moment, who sees Jesus first. She comes and the stone's been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, which by the way, anybody for free today, who's the other disciple? It's John, it's the guy who's writing the story down, which I love the next part of this. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved. I know a dead man's risen, but I need to tell you guys, I'm Jesus' favorite. I love that, man, it's so great. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said, they've taken the Lord out of the tomb and we don't know where they have put him. So Peter, again, and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. Listen, guys, I know dead men are walking around here, but I'm really fast. I mean, it's just great. If I was writing the story, man, I'd write it the same way. I'm telling you, I would sort of one-up Peter in this moment. The other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And so if you read the story, you sort of begin to realize they're just telling people. They're just trying to get as many people into this announcement. It's a game of telephone right away. And they're doing exactly what you would do. They're doing exactly what I would do. They're essentially, they've taken to social media. That's what they're doing. They're telling everybody. They're trying to get this announcement out to as many people as they possibly can. John, I love this, where he says, you know, and he outran the other disciple. What is John doing there? He's put himself in the story. That's a first century selfie right there is what that is. I was there, man. I was in the middle of it. They're telling people who tell people who tell people, and this begins to spread amongst the populace in Jerusalem. He bent over and looked at the strips of linen lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there. So the death garments and Lazarus' story, if you've read that story, when Lazarus comes out of the tomb, he's wrapped in the death garments. When Jesus comes out of the tomb, the death garments are on the ground. He had no intention of returning to death because he has put death to death. And it says the death garments are still there. as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was lying in his place, separate from the linen. He folded his laundry. I just love that detail right there. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, in case anyone forgot, also went inside. He saw and he believed. He saw and he believed. They still did not understand from the scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying. And they begin to tell people who tell people who tell people. If you're here and there's something in you that goes, you know what, Easter's a nice idea, it's a universal truth, you know, the world's kind of telling us everything that dies gives way for something else to live, you will be tempted to dismiss what we just read as a legend or a fairy tale. In fact, a lot of people in the world would say this story of John, of Matthew, of Luke, it's a fairy tale, it's a legend. Here's the problem with that. How they have written this story is not the language of fairy tales, and it's not the language of legends. It is the language of a historical event. It's the language of people who saw something. It's written down as a journalist would write a story down. This is what we have seen. It's that personal to them. It's not a legend. It's not written down as a fairy tale. Commentators often note this as you read through the story. One thing that we sort of read over, but it's very, very bizarre that they do, is in Matthew's account and John's account, it's always women who see Jesus first. You ever notice that? It's Mary Magdalene. As you read the other accounts, it's the women who see this story first. It's Joanna who sees in Luke's account, who see Jesus first. That's an odd detail because in the Roman world, where this message begins to spread throughout the Roman Empire, Roman women, or women in the first century world, they were so lowly thought of, their testimony was not admissible in a court of law. Which means that if you were going to make up a story about a dead man walking, a fairy tale, a legend that you wanted people to believe, the last thing you would do is say that it began with women, that women were the first ones to see it. The only reason you would include that detail is because it's what you saw. It was women that saw Jesus first. The language of the story, and historians and literary experts, as they read through this, as they've read through this for 2,000 years, they will tell you, legends are written historically from the perspective of an omniscient narrator. Someone who is outside of the story, they understand the emotional arc of characters, they see into the future, they know what's going to happen, what has happened. That is not the language of this story. They're just telling you what they've seen. They're not describing the emotional arc of the people who are witnessing it. They don't know what's going to happen. They're not omniscient narrators. And another detail that you notice as you read through the story, they footnote everything, don't they? They're naming names. Mark's account, it's Rufus, it's Alexander. Luke's account, it's Winona and Judd. It's all, you know, they're naming all these. It happened in Nashville, in case you're wondering. They're naming all these names again and again. You know why they're doing that? Because they're saying, go ask them. I want you to see for yourself. I want you to ask someone else who was there. That is not what fairy tales do. They believed it was a historical event. They began to spread this message, not as something that they wanted people to believe in. They did, but they were spreading it because they were just telling people what they saw. It was personal to them because they saw it with their very own eyes. It cannot be dismissed as legend and as fairy tale. If you saw something incredible today, maybe on your way to church, and you thought, how am I going to explain this to people? Maybe it was an elephant riding on a bicycle, you know, and you came to church, Jared, you're not going to believe what I saw. What would you do? You would start telling me, you know, you got to ask my Uncle Josh. He was there. She was in, my sister, you know, Marie was in the car. You would start trying to validate your story. You would do exactly what the disciples did. You would tell me where it happened. If you were going to make up a story like that, you would say, once upon a time, you know, you would not give any details for that to be validated. This is the language of a historical event. And the disciples quickly realize if this is a historical event, if this is something that they've seen, then it also is an irritating reality. And I would say it's an irritating reality for us, if we're honest. If we don't spiritualize it, and if we don't just sort of set it on a shelf and kind of spray a Thomas Kincaid kind of sheen over it, if we let it be as raw and gritty as it actually is, it's an irritating reality. It was in the first century world. It was for the Jewish populace that begins to hear this and receive this. We know from history that this message of Easter within hours of the resurrection 2,000 years ago begins to spread amongst the Jewish populace in and around Jerusalem. The populace that lives there to this very day is predominantly Jewish. And Jews were the last ones who would ever worship a man. In the Jewish tradition, obviously to this very day, God is so other, God is so holy. Anyone in the Old Testament who's ever seen God, their eyes blow out of their sockets. They fall over dead. He is so holy. He's relegated to one corner of the Temple Mount where heaven meets earth. The thought that Jews of all people would begin to worship within hours or weeks of the resurrection, that would be so offensive to them. And yet, what does Luke tell us? Luke 24 tells us that right away, within weeks of the resurrection, Jews are bowing down to a man named Jesus. And this would be a horribly irritating reality for them. It was an irritating reality for the disciples. These 11 guys who've seen this with their very own eyes, they knew in the Roman Empire to begin to spread this message, this was not going to get them rich, this was going to get them killed. That they would all be convicted of crimes of heresy and be killed for what they saw. There was no religious freedom in this world. You couldn't just go around saying this stuff, and you wouldn't go around saying this stuff of a dead man walking unless it was something that you saw. It was an irritating reality for them. And I would say, if we're honest, Easter has to become an irritating personal reality for us. You say, what in the world are you talking about? Here's what I mean. We live in a culture where we Yelp review everything, don't we? We live in a culture where we make decisions about all of life, vacations, restaurants, whatever it is, based on what we like or what we don't like. It is the culture of the thumb, isn't it? It's the culture of Rotten Tomatoes. Do I like it? Do I not? We even do this, if we're honest. We don't just do it with vacations and restaurants. We do this with our beliefs. If you and I were to sit down over coffee and I were to say, well, what do you believe about religion or the Bible or money or sex or power? You would tell me your beliefs. And the reason you have those beliefs is because you like them. You say, I like this idea. I don't like this idea. We even Yelp review the Bible as we read through it. I was talking with a guy not that long ago, and he had just started reading the Bible. He goes, I like the Ten Commandments. They make sense. I don't like the Sermon on the Mount. You know, 5 stars for Moses, 3 stars for Jesus. You know, sort of, as we read we do this with everything in life. And here's why I say that, because your Yelp review of Easter is irrelevant, isn't it? It's either true or it's not true. If it's not true, as Paul says to the church in Corinth, eat, drink, be merry, go on with your life, everything in the Bible. If Easter did not happen, this is just Aesop's fables. This is just fairy tale and legend, and none of it is applicable to your life. But oh my goodness, if Easter happened, if resurrection took place, every morsel of this is now applicable to your life, isn't it? Everything Jesus said about how to serve the poor and love the poor and treat the poor is applicable to your life if Easter took place. Every irritating detail of the scripture is now applicable to your life. Everything Jesus said about forgiveness and loving your enemies and forgiving those who've hurt you and caused you pain, if Easter actually happened, all of that is relevant to your life. And every word that Jesus said is now applicable, and you have to pay attention to it. If it didn't happen, who cares? But Easter is not interested in your Yelp review of if you like it or if you don't. Easter just simply asks the question, is it true or is it not true? And if you believe that it's true, it has to make the words of Jesus, the teachings of Jesus, an irritating reality that confronts every behavior and choice that we make in this life. It was an irritating reality for Paul. As you read through the New Testament, the guy who wrote a majority of the New Testament, he hated Christians. He was so offended by the idea. He was a Jewish man. He was so offended by the idea that people were bowed down to a man, that a man could be God. And yet he comes to the moment in Acts chapter 9, if you've read the story, he sees Jesus. He realizes resurrection has happened. He sees it with his very own eyes. And then he has that moment of, oh my goodness, what does this mean? It means I have to be humble. It means I have to begin to tell people what I've seen. He has to bring his life, because it just changes everything. It all of a sudden makes the teachings of Jesus, the life of Jesus, even if the teachings and the words cut against the grain and the fabric of your life, it's now applicable and it matters. It's an irritating reality. It was for the disciples and it is for us. This is why Easter has to be the linchpin of your faith. It has to be the thing that your faith is built around. Your faith cannot be built around the Bible, because here's what will happen. Eventually, you will read a verse that you don't understand. You will Yelp review the Bible, and you will walk away from faith. It happens all the time. In fact, if you have friends who've walked away from faith, what do they point to? There's something in the Bible that they don't like. And if that's the foundation of your faith is fragile. If the church is the foundation of your faith is fragile. Because believe it or not, eventually you will meet Christians who are judgmental and cruel, won't you? Hard to believe, I know. And if the church is the foundation of your faith, eventually you will Yelp review the church, you will thumbs down the church, and you will push away from faith. If it's the church, if it's the Bible that's the foundation of your faith is incredibly fragile. But if it's Easter that's the foundation of your faith, the resurrection of Jesus, Easter will be that hand on your shirt that keeps you coming back into the presence of Jesus again and again. Easter won't let you go, because you will be so awestricken with the reality that it's true. And what else are you gonna do but fall down at his feet and worship him? It's an irritating reality. It's personal. It's a personal truth. It becomes an irritating reality if it's a historical event. And I think the third thing they would say, and maybe the most significant thing they would say, definitely the most personal thing they would say, is that Easter put death to death. It wasn't just about the death of Jesus. It's about your death. It's about the death of every person in your life that you've ever lost that you love. And it put death to death once and for all. The church in Corinth was confused at this. They began to ask Paul, what happens to people when they die? A fair question. I think our world still grapples and wrestles with that question. And Paul's answer is essentially the same thing that happened to Jesus. In the same way he was physically resurrected is a historical event. There will be a future event where someone that you know and love in Jesus, they will be risen from the dead, and there will be a physical embrace. What does Jesus do right when he's risen from the dead? It's a bizarre story. And we'll read part of this next week. But if you go to John chapter 21, you see Jesus has defeated death. Easter has taken place. The disciples have all scattered. They're scared to death. They know what they have seen is going to make them outlaws in the Roman Empire. They go back to Nazareth, 64 miles or so to the north. They're on the Sea of Galilee. And Jesus comes walking up. And this is the scene. They've all scattered. John 21, verse 7. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved, again, come on, John, said to Peter, "It is the Lord." So they see him. In the history of death, when someone has died, they are irretrievable. It's irreversible. You can't do anything about it. In the history of death up until this moment, death is final, it's over, it's done. And yet in this moment, "It is the Lord," Peter declares. As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, "It is the Lord," he wrapped his outer garment around him. They're on the Sea of Galilee, for he had taken it off, and he jumps into the water. Oh my goodness, a dead man walking. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from the shore, about 100 yards off. When they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals, and there were fish on it, and there was some bread. In the history of death, as Jackson was talking about in his video, when you lose your stepdad, when you lose a loved one, it is over, it is finished, it's done. When they saw Jesus crucified, there was no hope in their mind that this scene would take place. And it's a bizarre scene, isn't it? He's risen from the dead. There's no celestial announcement. He's not floating on clouds. He's not hanging out with Morgan Freeman in a white building. He's not speaking in a James Earl Jones voice to the disciples in this moment. It's shockingly earthy, isn't it? Fish and chips, that's what we're doing. What in the world? He's saying it's real. Don't spiritualize it. Don't make heaven a floaty cloud and some kind of palatial palace that's a bunch of ghosts floating around. He says, this is what it looks like when Jesus' kingdom has come on earth as it is in heaven, and death has been defeated and death has been put to death. It is shockingly earthy. It is shockingly tangible. And here's what he's announcing to the entire world, that as real as this scene is, where Peter is going to embrace what he thought death had taken away, so will you embrace those that you thought death had taken away. And as real as fish and chips on a table, it is that tactile, it is that tangible, it is that profoundly earthy. Easter is the announcement that whatever death has robbed from you in this life, it will be restored. Easter is the announcement that whoever death has robbed from you in this life, you will get it back. And it is real as Peter on the shore of the Sea of Galilee, seeing it with his own eyes, breaking bread with him, you will have that moment back with the deceased. And the Bible is not the foundation of that, and the church is not the foundation of that. Easter and Easter alone is the foundation of that. And the disciples would announce, it is that personal. It is that personal. Every other faith will tell you that heaven is a consolation prize. That's what it is. You live a good life in this earth, you do good things. One day when you die, you get the consolation prize of heaven. And as Christians, we often want to turn heaven into the consolation prize for a life of really trying hard to be a good Christian. And Easter announces to us that heaven is not a consolation prize. Heaven is a restoration of all things broken by death. That's what it is. The death gets shattered in the face of Easter. And the church at Corinth was asking Paul, what does this mean? In 1 Corinthians 15, he says, if the dead are not raised, if there is not some power over death, in the same way that Jesus embraced Peter on the Sea of Galilee, the same thing will happen in your future. Your future is profoundly personal, and it is profoundly earthy and tactile and real. And Easter is what turns it into that, nothing else. Easter put death to death. Which is why Jackson in his video is not some ethereal, floaty, it's real and personal to him. And it's supposed to be real and personal to us, the resurrection announcement. It's why the third day is the best day. It's not a consolation prize. It's a restoration of all broken things. There's two anniversaries all weekend that I have been reflecting on. One, the loss of a very dear friend. And a year ago yesterday in this very room, we had his celebration of life service. Some of you know Brad Reimers was his name. He was the chairman of our board here at the church for a long time. 15 months, Brad and his family battled cancer, lost his battle with cancer. And a year ago in this room, preached his funeral, celebration of life. And it's only because of Easter that I could look at Miriam, Brad's wife, I could look at his four sons, and I could say, because of Easter, your best days with your dad are in front of you, they're not behind you. Only Easter makes that possible. It's a restoration of all things broken by death. This past Friday was my 10th wedding anniversary to Rosanna. That was only the women clapping, and that's because I remembered. Did he really remember that? That's incredible. And as we, not exactly a day, it was Good Friday, not exactly a day you want to get the champagne out, you know what I mean? But it was a day where we reflected on the last 10 years, and we were both struck by the irretrievability of life, the irreversibility of time. And I know some of you are going, dude, I've been married 45 years, you have no idea. But life is like sand between your fingers, isn't it? And you can't hold it, you can't get it back, it's gone. And there's moments where we look back on taking kids home from the hospital, we look back on houses that have been sold, great memories, our wedding. And some of those moments that you go, those were the best days, those are the best moments, and they're just gone. There is an irretrievability to life and an irreversibility to time that if you really stop and think about it, it will break your heart. Some of us in this room, that's you feel like before you get to your funeral, you've already had 1,000 literal little funerals of just mourning the irreversibility of time and the irretrievability of the moments that have mattered to you. And it starts to shrink you down. You start to get bitter. You start to get cynical. As a mom, maybe you're raising kids right now, and everywhere you go, every restaurant you're in, you got, you know, yuck all over your face, and some parent will always come up to you, won't they? And they will say, hold on to these moments. It doesn't get any better than this. And you want to believe it, but you're in that moment, you're going, is this, you know, how do I hold on to it? It's irretrievable. It's irreversible. Some of us, you're broken, that your youth is gone. It's just gone. It's just how life works. How do you stand up in the face of the irretrievability of life? I'll tell you how you do it. You do it with Easter. Because Easter announces over you today that your best days are in your future. They're not in your past. Easter announces over you that the irretrievability of life will come back. Easter announces over you that time itself is reversible. You will get a brand new body. You get a brand new life. Not because the Bible says it so, not because the church says it so, but because Easter itself declares that it's true. And that's why Easter's personal. Let it be that personal to you today. The best way.